Matthew chapter 10, verse 24. We've been in ministry here for 9 years. In our 9 years, we've been on the front of the Anderson Star 43 times. I'm not trying to gloat. I'm going to prove a point. I promise you I will. We've done many functions. We did one function that we had over 900 people show up. We had five different states that got up in their car and drove to our function. We have done a lot in this area with a little. Our biggest functions we did, we only had two helpers besides my wife and I. Now we have more helpers. Now we can do more things. Some of you want to grow, don't you? Don't you? This is why the point that I'm giving you, all this that we have done. The student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. You can only grow as far as we grow. Do you understand what that means? You want more anointing? Then I need to get more anointing. Because as long as you're in our ministry, you can't supersede the anointing that's in the house. You want more? I want more. I want our ministry to do more for in the community. I want our ministry. And let me tell you, I know for sure that God will take something secular and work a miracle in it. I know he can do it because he's done it before. For those of you that got to hear Bishop David speak, and he said what I've told you before, in the middle of a classical concert where the light shattered and you see glass falling all over the place, but the light remained on. We know that's a natural impossibility. And people got healed at a classical concert. You know what that means? If you can't supersede what I'm doing, because the Bible says that, then you can at least match what I'm doing. Donna in her school, oh God, blow up some lights in here and let your anointing flow. It's in the house. You have Darcy works at the hotel. Father, let someone be healed as they just walk right by me. Can be equal to at least. Do you know how easy it is for someone to be converted? No, he didn't say that. Yes, I did. Do you know conversion is easy? We make it hard. Conversion is easy. It really is. It just, hey, change how you are, accept Jesus, now become something else. But we have to find that one time to where everything is falling apart for that individual to now present the good news. See, Jesus is our good news. Already paid the cost, so you don't have to pay it. Can you imagine if right now, I think Tiffany went with the kids, so she'll probably love to hear this. If right now someone grabbed Tiffany back there with the kids and handed her a paid ticket for two to Honolulu, you imagine? Oh, wait. I got to say it better because Shannon just heard me and he held back. If she were to get a ticket right now where she's at, a paid trip to Honolulu for two. Hotel, car rental, at the beach, tour guide. You know, if she got all of that and she was down and out, everything is going wrong. I got a ticket for what? This must be a scam. Then let me look it up and see if this is. This is not a scam. You know, all of a sudden all that stuff just falls off, right? Your light is about to be disconnected. Honolulu, honey, Honolulu. Your car is about to be repossessed. Rented one, paid for, Honolulu, baby, Honolulu. See, there's something about good news that makes bad news go away. I told my wife I wanted to take her to Spain. Forget everything else that I said, because all she heard, take you Spain. I opened my wallet, pulled out my credit card. She didn't say anything first, because she knows I speak in faith, so sometimes speaking faith takes time. And she knows I'm a man of faith, so I can say, hey, I want to take you to Spain. And she says, wait, Lord God, open the doors. But when she saw me open the wallet, she lost it. She was all over the house. Yeah! And got through and put it on the computer and got the flight and everything and put the credit card number and enter. And then the card was declined. Because I exceeded my daily limit. And I looked at her and said, honey, not today. I'm so sorry. And she went, oh. I said, but honey, tomorrow contact the bank and tell them we need our daily limit to be exceeded. And we shall buy it tomorrow. See, if my wife is having a hard day, if she's having a hard day right now, honey, in December, Spain. If that don't work, honey, December, Spain, Portugal. If that doesn't work, honey, Spain, Portugal, France. You see, when you hear good news, it makes bad things go away. We do not know how to give good news. We only know how to give bad. We go to people, you and I had to sit down on this one. And we bring them bad news. But Jesus came to bring us good news. So we're going to forget about me being the head of this local body and now think of Jesus being the head of our whole entire body. And now we're going to read this verse again. The student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. Oh, but Jesus had all the anointing, so that's great. I can do all things. And isn't that wonderful? Until we read verse 25. And it says, it is enough for a student to be like their teacher, and a servant like their master. If the head of the house has been called Beelzebub, how much more the members of the household? I can't exceed my covering, which is Christ. And if they talk bad about him, why am I complaining they're talking bad about me? See, I reposted something on Facebook, and the guy was saying that there was a time we as Americans did not get so easily afraid. We as American Christians get afraid so easily. A week or so ago, I went to the clinic and they had to give me a shot. And she's trying to prepare me for the stick. And I said, honey, it's just a little needle. I give blood. What? You give blood? Oh, yeah. No problem then. If you ever seen that needle for giving blood, it's a huge thing. You know, you got to watch them sticking in your arm and you are preparing yourself because, man, they're sticking a hose inside of me. Goodness gracious, good night. And there's no way you can stop that thing from not hurting. It's not like the little prick of a needle. It's not like... You're going to feel this a little afterwards when it starts to sting. I always wonder why they stuck you and then rubbed it. You know, they told me they're spreading it out. Then it starts to sting. But once you've had a needle to give blood, that other little needle is a little needle. You look at it and say, hey, I'm an expert at needles. You know, hey, give me the needle before you put that one to give blood. And then, see, I have high iron in my blood. And what they've told me with my blood is that they have to separate it. They can't give my blood to an individual because my iron content is too high. So they're separated. And they said, and we separate your blood, and your blood will all go to some infant somewhere. I have infant worthy blood. So they try to milk me. Oh, they do. They start pushing all the blood down in the bag. And it's like, I'm feeling a little woozy here. It's just a little bit more, just a little bit more. You get to the point of, is my chest supposed to be hurting? I think you're taking too much blood. We want to get it to where it can't fill anymore. I mean, the blood start coming up on the tube. And it's like, I think you should stop now. I'm telling you, they really, really milk me. But see, once you've gone through that process, you can do the little needle. Some of us forget that spiritually we've given blood already. Why are you afraid of a little needle? Come on, remind yourself of when you had a big needle in your arm. And, oh, that's going to be nothing, man. I'm not even going to feel that. It's going to go in and come back out again. And man, thank you. I remember being in the military. They gave me shots with an air gun. You have never had a shot until you had shots with air gun. And they're not nice, because you'll walk up and they have one on the left and one on the right. And you go in and it's like, pow, pow. Step forward. I don't want to. I already know what I'm going to experience. I don't like that. Step forward. Step forward. Oh, step forward. But you're doing all of that in the inside. In the outside, you're trying to be the soldier. I did not see anyone not go through the line. Somebody got it. Everyone who joined in the military had to go through it. And no one says, you crazy, you're not going to stick me with that stuff. And I don't know if you know this, sometimes they give soldiers injections of stuff that have not been tried before. And we are the guinea pigs. I can probably die out of this today, but I'm a soldier. If that one didn't kill me, maybe this one will. Hey, the odds are not for me. But we went through it. And then we get born again Christians and don't want to go through anything. For every little thing, we lose our faith. For every, I got a cold and God didn't answer my prayer and heal me, so I'm not going to church no more. Jesus suffered all things. The Lamb of God, the fair and 10,000, the bright and morning star, the lily of the valley, suffered it all, and God let it happen. And who are you? In comparison to Jesus, who am I? Absolutely nothing. From dirt have I come, and to dirt I shall return. I don't get to boast before God. Lord God, I am Bishop Ronaldo. I call you Ray. Yes, Lord. Yes, Abba, I'm but a little child. I am nothing. I am anointed. I have been to churches like that where I just want to slap the person. You know, it's just... because they start talking about themselves like, you know, they're one step below God. I have watched pastors as they would say something and the people frantically run to get done what he just said. Ooh, pastor asked me to do this. And I don't mind people doing stuff when I ask them to do. But don't ever put me in the category where I am so close to God that I can't fall. Because you'll make me fall. Because pride comes before the fall. I need to remind myself, stay humble. But at the same time, I can't be scared of the prick. I can't be scared that something is going to hurt me. Because when I start doing that, I stop limiting the anointing of God working in my life. I start saying things like, I don't ever want to go to another country because that's dangerous. And I don't know about eating that stuff. You know, that looks nasty. And I don't know. I see Benny Hinn doing that stuff, but I don't believe in the move of the Holy Spirit like that. And we start speaking junk and then wonder why our children are speaking junk back to us. Start speaking, wait a second, I've never considered going to another country, but I need to give it a second thought. Because maybe I'm spoiled and don't know it. Maybe this experience would open me up so what I'm doing now will be more effective. We need to change our little stinking thinking. Say, I have taken my kids to dangerous neighborhoods. On purpose. And I have watched how people reacted around them. I never told my kids when I took them, this is dangerous. Be very cautious. People kill other folks here for shoes. Yeah, I didn't tell them any of that. I just let them walk with me. They did not know that I am going to a place where the guy has already killed 16 people and I'm taking them along. They didn't know that. I didn't tell them. We just went. Why? Because as long as the Holy Spirit is with me, I'm going to finish what I started. If I'm called to do this, I'm called to do it. You know, I am convinced that neither life nor death, nor principalities or powers, nor darkness or rulers or high places, nothing can separate me from the love of God. I am convinced about that. I will not be afraid. But it's hard when you're ministering to people and you're bold enough to go somewhere and they're looking at you like you're an oddball. Like you're the only one that will go into somewhere dangerous. When there are millions of people who are doing it right now. Not the only one that's crazy enough to believe that God. I was watching a documentary of Papua New Guinea. And the missionary that was sent to Papua New Guinea has lived over there since the 60s. And now there are Christian churches all over Papua New Guinea because of this missionary and his wife. Here's the thing. They were headhunters when they got there. Not only did they cut off your head, they will eat you. They were cannibals. And God sent them there. And they got up and they went. Now every church that's in Papua New Guinea is because of their ministry. Don't you think God has a reward for that? Well, it's that they're not afraid. That's not true. Here's the thing about fear, it comes. It comes. Pastor, you mean at times you get afraid? Yes, I do. Well, why? Because I am mortal, not immortal. I get afraid. But I know where when I get afraid, I act just like the two little girls that I put right here before service. I act just like a little girl. What do you mean? Let lightning and thunder start being loud in my house in the middle of the night and let it wake up a little Lizzie. You know what she's gonna do? She's gonna run to my room, jump in my bed, get right beside me, move mom over, cover herself up. I'm protected with daddy. I know where to run when I get afraid. See, I have my daddy too. And my daddy says, you can come on in. Just come on in. Just push the door open. Father, I am afraid. Can you hold me? He's my comforter. He was sent to bring me comfort. Son, yes, I called you to do this, but I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. You understand that we can't understand the word never as people because we never fulfill our goal. I shall always be your parent and never let you down. What? How many parents here have never let their child down before? How many of you parents never had your parent let you down? See, we don't understand the word never really because we are fallible. But God said he'll never forsake you. I remember being in Peru, and in Peru, they're smoking all the trash, and it's a desert region where I was. And you're thinking, Lord God, let me today not have any sinus problems. I've never gone to the mission field and have had to suffer with sinus issues. Why am I dealing with sinus issues now? Father, do you not want me to be here? Just take this away. Father didn't take it away. Father, let me have it anyway. Okay, Lord God, you didn't take it away, so I got to just deal with what I got. Thank you, Father, because even with the sinus issues, you haven't left me. You haven't forsaken me. Jesus suffered through all things. Here's the thing, it's not written all the other things he suffered through. I know this one thing. At 12 years old, he was with his earthly dad. And after 12 years old, you never heard of his earthly dad anymore. At the cross, we know that his earthly dad had to be dead. Because he looked at John the Beloved and said, John, here's your mother. Mother, here's your son. He wouldn't have to do that if his dad was still living. His dad was dead. Here is life, Jesus, watching his dad be buried. You know, Jesus could have spoke him back to life, but he suffered to be so. Come, one of y'all are going to get it. He allowed it to be so he can suffer through it. So he can suffer through, now I'm the man of the house. Now I have to take care of my mom. Now I have to earn an income. I have to provide for her. And even to the point of death, I still have to provide for you, and I won't be alive, so I'll give you a new son so he can provide for you in my place. See, we're so afraid of suffering, but don't know that suffering gives us character. You want to be somebody? Go through something. Haven't you been tired to be around shallow people that are full of opinions but haven't tested anything out? I have some students that I've hired to teach our kids. And I said, here is going to be your proving ground. A lot of the things that you've learned, you're going to throw it out. And a lot of the things that you've never learned before, you're going to discover. And that's what you're going to do. I'm here for you as I am for the students. So they got a lot of head knowledge. But I've been teaching for 33 years. What they teach in school that works, I've already had the opportunity to tell you, it don't work. It sounds good. You are not allowed to touch any of the children. So do everything in your power not to touch them. Don't put your hand on them anywhere. So nothing will be brought up against you after. You cannot teach and not touch a child. I mean, that's just ridiculous. You got bumped into. Oh, I didn't mean to bump into you. You can't sue me for that. You the one that bumped into me. I didn't bump. Come on. That's nonsense. It's not practical. You're going to bump into each other eventually. You're going to touch someone on the head eventually. You're going to put your hand on the shoulder eventually. You're going to graze their hand eventually. You might even touch regions you're not supposed to by accident. I'm sorry. Didn't mean to. It's not something that is doable. And we come to church with those crazy notions that the world has taught us. We can't do all this stuff. And the Bible wants us. God, Jesus went and he laid hands on people. He touched them. Not only did he touch them, he allowed them to touch him. Not practical, not doable. Head knowledge, good for nothing. Learn it, take the test, throw it away. God wants us to get to the point that we're not afraid to suffer. I have watched these daredevils. Young folks, y'all seen them too? The daredevils, the one that will get on these little, what they call it? Skateboard. And see a ramp. But the ramp has a staircase with it. And then they decide, ooh, this looks like a good idea. Let me get the middle of my skateboard to be on that metal thing all the way to the bottom. That sounds fantastic. Fell down, broke something, got a cast, go through the whole healing thing, get right back on the skateboard. I'm gonna try it again. You know, we need to be some daring Christian people to look at it and say, you know, I'm gonna try it. Yeah, there is a possibility I will break my neck. But what doesn't kill me makes me stronger. Sit, and I'm not telling you to go get a skateboard. That's not what I said. Okay, I'm talking about when you're looking at someone, I don't know how to be able to present the gospel to them. Get on your spiritual skateboard, and I may fail at this one. But wait till I recover, I will try it again. I watched that this year in the Olympics, they made this little down slope thing. It's almost like a direct fall in the snow. But they are on these boards. They don't have wheels, it's just boards. And the same crazy nut that learned how to do that on some little stairway is representing our nation. Come on, someone get it. They had to start right there with what they had. No one created a safe environment for them to do stuff so they can get that technique down pack. They used what they had. And here we are, we need this and we need that and we need the other way. Wait, isn't there a stairway over there? Wait, they got a sidewalk over here on Quintard, don't they? There's a bridge, I saw it. Don't the neighbor has an empty pool? You see, they get creative, inventive, daring. They'll break one leg, and the next time they break the other, and they break a wrist, they fracture their skull. They go through all of that. But don't you know they know the whole time they're about to start that there's a possibility they'll get hurt? What makes them keep going? You'll be surprised when I tell you. You want to know what keeps them going? The person next to them who's watching them. They're not doing it by themselves. That someone have the little foam filming to put it on YouTube. See, just the expectation that someone else is going to view this, someone else is going to see this, that this is going to be effective for someone else causing them to do it. And here we are, scared of the person next to us because they're going to say something bad about us when they should be the ones saying, go ahead, try it. I'm filming the whole thing. See, we got it backward, don't we? The one who is at church is supposed to be the one encouraging you. I watched this other thing on YouTube. It was the funniest video I had seen. I posted it. I don't think anybody liked it because it looked really silly in the beginning. They're in a parking lot, and you can see the snow in the background. And there's a guy that his friends are urging him to jump in the puddle. And you can tell that this guy is really serious. You know, and he looks at the puddle, and he looks at the camera, and he says, I am doing it for the children. And he's supposed to be just jumping in a puddle, but he did not know it was a hole. In snow, I mean water, he jumps in and the water just swallows him up. He comes out all soaking wet. For the children, no one knew it was a big old hole. How about if we start doing that for the Lord? I encourage you to jump in that puddle. I know it's cold, but can you do it for the children? See, you can get a message on whatever you're watching, you know, because I do. I watch some stuff, and I'm like, that is so silly, so funny, and then the Holy Spirit begins to speak to me through just the little silly thing I just saw. Ronaldo, when did you get to the point that you'll jump in a puddle in the middle of the cold weather for me? And when do you get this kind of intestinal fortitude that you'll say, I'm going to do it for the children? Who cares how wet I get? Let's get to the point that fear is just something that comes and goes. Because it will if you let it. Fear can come. But if you pay little attention to it, it will go. We've had the opportunity of having lots of kids come to our house. And when they come and spend the night to our house, guess what we do? We scare the tar out of them. Every time they come over, we scare the tar out of them. And eventually, by the time they're teenagers, they're not afraid any longer. And it's like, why are you doing that? That's silly. I'm not afraid no more. I was afraid when I was younger. But you've taught me fear can be fun. Oh, some of you have missed that, right? You go to scary things on purpose because fear can be fun. All right, let's start dealing with the enemy the same way. Bring it on. I like it. Come on. Hey, I need some excitement in my life. Bring it on. Come on. I'm ready for this crazy ride. I waited all my life for one of my kids to be old enough to go on a roller coaster ride with me. Oh, my life is like, come on, you're tall enough now. Go on the roller coaster ride with me. But my son was afraid. And my son said, no, Daddy, I don't want to go. Oh, Lord God, my son, oh, I've been waiting. He don't even know. I've been counting the days he was tall enough so he can go on this ride with me, but he is afraid. And Ariel said, Daddy, as soon as I'm tall enough, I'll go with you. And I'm looking at Ariel, you just saying that now because you're short. I want to see when you get tall enough. And as soon as Ariel got tall enough, Daddy, can we go on the ride? And we got on the roller coaster ride, and I began to teach her some things about life. I said, when it starts to go down and fall down, you're coming up, hold on. It's anticipation. But when you start to fall, raise up both hands. See, life is like a roller coaster, but you can miss the ride if you're afraid. When it starts to come down, glory to God. Raise up both hands. I'm going to enjoy the ride. The loop-de-loop and going around and everything. You know what Ariel did after our first roller coaster ride? Daddy, can we do it again? And I wasn't feeling that hot that day. I picked up a bug from the park. Right there in the park, I picked up a bug. And I wasn't feeling too hot. And I said, Ariel, can we do it another time? I'm not feeling too good. We got to Tampa, Florida. Go to Busch Garden. Supposedly they had a brand new ride. And this one, your legs are sticking out. You're strapped into a chair with nothing but the chair and the strap sustaining you. And Ariel said, Daddy, I want to go on that ride. But I watched that ride as it went on a loop-de-loop. Your legs were up in the air. And then they did a little twirling thing coming down, and I thought to myself, maybe I'm getting old, but I'm intimidated by this ride. But my daughter is excited, so perk up and pretend you're not afraid. I got on that ride, it scared the tar out of me. But Ariel brought new life into me because someone else was not afraid. God wants to get us to the point, don't be afraid of suffering. You know that that ride is a form of suffering. You ever got that feeling in your stomach? You coming down, I was like, oh, that's because the force of gravity is greater there. You're doing like 4 G's. You feel it all in your stomach. That's not a good feeling. That feels bad. And you paid to go through it. And we're going through normal life, and we get that little gut feeling, and we start to cry. Come on, enjoy the ride. It will be over. You're not going to be in an eternal hoop-de-loop. You'll come out of it. And when you come out of it, you better be like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, where they come out and don't smell like fire. Hey, I was in the middle of it. I got way in there. Do you know that they didn't have to go into fire? Did you know that? Don't you think they were afraid? They didn't know God was going to take them out of there. They said, our God is able to deliver us. They didn't say, our God will deliver us. He is able to deliver us. I would have loved to see that king when he looked into the furnace. The guards that threw him in there died just from being close to the fire. Come over here. I sometimes give him Spanish names. Rodolfo, come over here. Didn't we throw three people in there? We did throw three people. How many people were in there? I thought I saw four or two, but wait a second. No, that fourth one looks different. That fourth one don't look like the third, the three. That one looks like the Son of God. See, in the middle of your fire, God wants to be there. In the middle of you going through, God wants to be there. But you got to go through so God will be there. They all came out. Have you ever been close to someone who smokes? It doesn't matter how hard you try, you're going to smell like cigarette. I mean, you can even just walk by as they're smoking in front of the grocery store. You just walk by, you spray that smell on me. I need to find a Febreze. Any of you have ever Febreze yourself in the store? I know I have. I mean, I can't stand the smell of cigarette. It's like, it works. I mean, just walk by it and you get to smell like it. But what about being in it and don't smell like it? See, God's promise can deliver you of any circumstance. You can be in it and come out and untouched by it. But here's the thing, you got to go in. Stop being afraid of suffering. What if not? Have you ever stayed up at night thinking of the what if? Am I the only person that has done that? What if that? What if the other? Lose a whole night's sleep facing the new day and none of the what ifs happen. Lost all my sleep for nothing. Jesus was on board a boat while his disciples were trying all they could not to be capsized. And they looked at Jesus and saw him sleeping. See, I think that Jesus is the type of person that the worst things got is the better sleep he got. I really am convinced because I have been so tired, so exhausted. I'm one of those really like sleepers. But I've been to the point of so exhausted that I am sleeping while my little kids are jumping on the bed. I've had a few days like that. So in my mind, I see Jesus sitting at the very end of the boat. I can't believe he's asleep. Jesus! Jesus! What? Don't you care? I always care. What am I not caring about? Don't you care? We're about to die. We are. Y'all look fine to me. It's not us. It's the wind and the waves. You woke me up for that. Didn't you learn anything? Why did you wake me up for? I was getting some good sleep. Can't wake me up because of wind and waves. And Jesus just get up and can I go back to sleep now? Come on, in the middle of the storm, all he said is, peace, be still. Your storm that you are in right now can end with a peace of God. Don't be afraid. He's right there on the boat. He's not ignoring you. He's right there. Think about it. How can they die when he can resurrect them? What were they afraid of? They drown, pull them back to the shore. Life come back into you. Thank you, Jesus. We're afraid of things we shouldn't be afraid of. Because if God is for us, tell me who can be against you? Come on. Tell me who, which kingdom can stand against the kingdom of God? Tell me who can rise up and says, I am as powerful as God is. Tell me who, which government, which people, which nation, which authority, which power can rise up against the power of the Almighty? And I'm afraid. But I'm glad that he looked down at me and says, you know what, you're not supposed to be afraid. Hey, come on. Go ahead, get in the bed. Go to sleep. Rest, because I'm with you. I'm with you. When we are talking about ministering to other nations, that doesn't take away from ministering in our city. That doesn't take away ministering to someone in Burger King. Ministering to someone in McDonald's. Yesterday, we took some of the youth out, and we ate at a restaurant, and our youth acted crazy. The night before, we had a formal where they had to learn etiquette, and the next day, they were just acting crazy. And we let them act crazy, and they were allowed. And everyone was staring at our table. But what I noticed about our kids is that they are so bold now that they knew their eyes were on them. And instead of being, okay, I'm going to get quiet now because people are looking at me, they got even louder. And everyone that looked at us couldn't help themselves but smile at our table. There is something about joy that can break the stigma of society. Amen. See, they can look at our table, and they knew automatically our table is different than most tables. Because in our table, we had white and we had black. And we were all talking to each other, and we were enjoying each other's company, and we were acting silly together. And when you look at other tables, white, black, other, and there was no mixing together. I believe that we were ministering unity to somebody. I went right after we were leaving, I went to the table right next to us. I said, pardon us if we made your lunch unbearable. And she looked at me and says, I enjoyed y'all being right there. See, when we start giving boldness to our kids, don't stop it. Don't tell them this is the area, you know, all these people paid to endure their meal. Stop all the snickering and laughing and all. Let them be kids. Let them enjoy it. Don't give them fear. Fear is taught. Don't put fear into them. So when they see that God is, God the Father is speaking to them, go and talk to this person right over here. Hey, I know how to talk loud in front of people. I can go talk to you right here. It is a liberty. I can do it because I've been given a liberty while I was young to do it. It's no fear. Your kids are afraid of stuff. Mom, dad, you're for hope. You taught them. Grandma taught them. Granddad taught them. Papa. Someone taught them. I've watched my kids when they were little. Don't touch that. That's going to hurt you. I had to teach them one not to touch because they were not afraid of it. I watched a little man put his hand in the fire. In my house. No, boy, you're going to get burned. Fire hot. Hot fire. Fire hot. Little man looked at me, hot. Papi, hot. Yes, hot. Fire. Yes, hot. Hot fire. But fearless. No fear. Afraid of nothing. And here we are, Christians, afraid of everything. Now we gotta undo. Spiritually, fire's hot, but fire won't burn you. Spiritually. Come on. Spiritually, you want fire. Spiritually, and fire. Come on, we got to unlearn some things. I watched that little boldness in the little man. I said, you know, God's going to use that. God's going to use that little boldness. I look at the parents and I think it's wearing under that. Don't kill that. Direct it, but don't kill it. Yeah, direct it. Grab it in that way. Why that way? We want stubbornness in this direction. We want him to remain stubborn. Well, that don't make any sense. Yes, it does. When someone is telling them to be homosexual, it's okay. Be stubborn. It's not okay. A fornication is okay. Be stubborn, boy. Be stubborn. Be stand your ground. Don't move. We want those characters in our kids. So when you look at your kids, don't sit there, oh, I have to undo. No, redirect. Raise up another child in the way that he should go. And when he is old, he will not depart from it. Let's not teach our kids to be afraid. My wife is taking the kids outside to pray on Sundays, sometimes on Saturdays. First time she said that, they didn't want to go. Now, they'll get up there and they'll pray. And then, wait. I feel from God we need to go to that parking lot and pray. Walk to someone else's parking lot and start praying. Wait, now I feel we need to go to that parking lot and pray. Go to someone else's parking lot and pray. Well, what are we preparing them for when it's no longer a parking lot? That's what we're preparing them for. Hear from God. Go whichever direction he tells you to go. The parking lot doesn't have people. It's a lot. Eventually, they'll be going to people. Well, if we are teaching them to be afraid, then we need to learn how not to be afraid first. We need to be the first ones. You know, I don't understand this, but I can see this is from God. Father, help me. Help me not break down what you are building up. I see my kid is aiming a certain direction, and it's uncomfortable to me. But Father, break me down so I can be what you want me to be. We have some people right now that come from a very racial background. And to come here, things broke down. When we started our first ministry, there's a gentleman that came up every Sunday and asked for forgiveness. I think I've told you this story before. He says, Ronaldo, you've heard about the burning bus? I said, I have. I was the first one to throw that cocktail. I forgive you. That means everything to me. No, it doesn't. Now you need to forgive yourself. Forgive you. How can I do that? Because Jesus forgave you long before you threw that cocktail. Forgive you. Get over it. It was done. It's over with. It's history. Now let's move on. Stop being afraid. Move on. Everyone in here, understand that fear is a spirit. Fear is a spirit. And God has not given us a spirit of fear. But he has given unto us. He has given us a spirit of power, a spirit of love, and a right mind. You get afraid? Wait, that's not mine. Start knocking back in the enemy's door. You get afraid? Hello, Satan? It's for you. That's yours, buddy. That's not mine. That's not my UPS box. It has the wrong label. Send it back to sender. It's not mine. I will not be afraid. I have been watching now young people coming and helping us from our school, and we had some professors to come and help us. And do you know the things that we're doing in our ministry are things that are not supposed to be done? I'm not supposed to be inviting university students to come and help. You know what I'm supposed to be doing? Come on, church, y'all help. It's your church, it's your function. I'm breaking the rules. Because if we want to be one, we have to start acting like one. Everybody jump on board. Everybody has an important part to play. All of you in here have an important part to play. You hear our missionaries when they come in next week? I want their words to stir something up in you. I don't want you to come back and leave here all empty. If you feel, man, I need to experience this once in my lifetime. All of you have heard of the bucket list. Put a mission trip on a bucket list. Put it on. I need to do this one time in my life and get the experience out of it. You know, experiences cost. Yeah, I said about Spain and Portugal and France, and if I were to ask right now, if I pay for the trip, how many of you want to go? Oh, everybody raise their hand. But if I say, hey, mission trip to Ethiopia, I'll pay for it. No, but God will have to speak to me himself. I'm going to lose money while I'm gone. What about my business? Come on, you see some experiences we automatically deem as being not good experiences, while those are the experiences that are worthy to be had. When we go on mission trip, we have a little relaxation, reflection time, and man, we really enjoy those because we're enjoying them, knowing that everyone around us does not have the opportunity to enjoy what we enjoy. Went to Panama together, did the whole mission experience, went to the beach, and lo and behold, we were the only ones there. As far as we can see, we eventually saw a four-wheeler and pass by. Well, he has a four-wheeler. Then I had the nerve to ask, beach, beautiful people, working. Huh? American, no work, beach. Panamanian, work, no beach. We got to enjoy something that's there all the time, but they can't enjoy it because they can't afford the luxury of one day off. Look at the freedom that we have. We have so much freedom. Now we need to stop being afraid and be the church that God has commanded us to be. God tells you to speak to someone and when Dixie go open your mouth. What should I say? Start with hello. That always works for me. Just start something. I know you were expecting a very spiritual answer, right? Start with what you got. Don't sit there and I'm going to tell them about John 3:16, and then I'm going to go to James chapter 1 verse 2, and then I'm going to go to Hebrews and talk about, you know, the hallmark of faith, and then I cut that out. Just open your mouth. Forget about what you're going to say, because God can speak through you without you even trying. Be courageous, that you be known as a generation of courageous people, not afraid. Speak. Open your mouth. There are people that in this city have died today that one of us have run into before that did not know God. The odds of being in a small city shows you that you have run into someone that died today. What about if they weren't saved? You have lost an opportunity. Now it's time to make up. Make up for what the canker worm ate up. Make up for what the locust ate up. Be vigilant of what the enemy is doing. He wants to silence us. Shh, don't say anything, church. You know it's not politically correct. Forget politics. My God says to start right here in my Jerusalem, Samaria, until the uttermost. Let's start. This week, try to give a testimony to somebody. All these coupon folks, y'all have the best opportunity. Man, it's just a platter brought to you. You start couponing, all the couponing people come to you. I've never seen anything like that before. You got coupon. Hey, you're doing the coupon thing. Hey, you know what? I am couponing and all my extra I am taking to the church because I believe that God is going to do something different in this area. And if you have any extra stuff, we welcome you. That let God use you. What does this have to do with God? Everything has to do with God, baby. God made those coupons. And then you can throw scripture in there. You can't? Yeah, God allows one to rise up and bring down another one. We're rising up by spending this coupon. God, make this coupon. Use what you got. My wife is ministering to people with coupons. You don't understand what I'm talking about. She did Ariel's whole birthday party without having to buy one single piece of food because her coupon people said, we got this. We'll get all the food you need for your girl's birthday party. They're not church folks, by the way. You see, you can use what you got. Kids in school, be vigilant. Look around you can minister to. I'm being really serious. My son had a function two or three weeks ago where he got to be with some of his friends his age, and that was the first time they got to be together. And finally got to know one of the young ladies that's a cheerleader. Got to know her better, and the next day her dad died. Don't you think God will let him get to know her better so he can have an influence? So he can be able to say something. It's not all just happenstance. Let's use what we got.